So now that we know the entire housing market in Singapore is worth 1.43 trillion Singapore dollars, what kind of insights can we draw from that? Hey guys, this is Mike Cho from UrbanZoom. Welcome to Data Stories, where we use data to tell you interesting stories about Singapore. So in the previous episode, we actually talked about how we use our auto-valuation AI, which we call Zoom Value, to basically value every single home in Singapore. And then when we add all those numbers up, we derive this figure of 1.43 trillion Singapore dollars, which is basically the combined value of all housing stock in Singapore. In this episode, what we're gonna do is to dive in a little bit deeper and see how we can slice and dice the number. So for instance, you can see here the split between freehold and leasehold for condo properties. In terms of absolute number of units, freehold actually only account for something like 40% versus leasehold, which account for 60%. But if you look at things in terms of value, dollar value, you can see that freehold actually contributes something like 51% or like 306 billion Singapore dollars versus that of leasehold, which is about 49%. In fact, if you break it down a bit further, you see that freehold in general is of a larger physical size. So basically the median size of a freehold unit, it's about 1,260 square foot versus that of leasehold, which comes in at only about 1,120 square foot. So we're really looking at a slightly more than 100 square foot kind of difference. And then on top of that, if you look at the price tag, turns out the median price per square foot for a freehold is a fair bit higher at close to 1,400 per square foot versus leasehold, which is just about 1,100 per square foot. So freehold typically bigger units as well as a pricier per square foot basis. So if you add up everything together, in terms of value, it actually accounts for 51%, even though in terms of number of units, it's actually just about 40%. I know some of you probably would be thinking, hey, you know, it makes sense because, you know, leasehold tend to be cheaper because of the depreciation effect, right? Now, I would actually be very hesitant to jump into that conclusion because we haven't actually taken into account one of the most important factors, which is location, right? If you think about it, a good location leasehold can easily be worth a lot more than a lousy location but freehold, right? So to really look into that effect, you need to look a lot deeper, which we'll hope to cover in a lot more detail in a future episode. So if you like this kind of thing, you know, definitely consider subscribing for that. But now let's get on to look at condo data again, but split things up by districts. So here's the chart. Again, just for condo, we are showing you the median price per square foot ranked by district. So traditionally, we always think about district 9, 10, 11, these are the expensive districts. But as you can see here, actually district 1, which basically is your Marina Raffles Place area, actually has the highest price per square foot, coming at just above 2,000 per square foot. And we're talking about the median price here. What's also interesting here is that there's actually a lot of units, turns out, at district 19, basically Hougang, Punggol area, with just over a median of 1,000 per square foot. So yeah, if you can't afford those crazy prices in downtown, but you still want your swimming pool in a condo setting, there are plenty of options, especially in District 19. Now let's jump into HDB a little bit and see how we can spin the numbers. If you segment everything by HDB town, you will find basically Tampines is the biggest in terms of the combined dollar value, right? Locking in at about 42 billion Singapore dollars. But if you look at things at from the median price per square foot kind of perspective, you'll find some of the more pricey HDB in Central area or Bukit Timah, right, which is kind of what you expect, at close to 600 bucks per square foot. But those are really small kind of like HDB town. Typically most people don't think of them, don't even realize that there may be HDB there. So if you look at the more sizable HDB town, Queenstown and Bishan, they are more expensive. They're coming in about 520 to 530 Sing dollar per square foot. And then on the other end of the spectrum, some of the cheapest HDB can be found in Choa Chu Kang and Woodlands. Another interesting way to look at HDB is to break things up by flat type. So as you can see here, 4-room is, as you probably expect, account for the biggest pie here, with a combined value of over 218 billion Singapore dollars, representing something like 42% of the entire HDB universe, with 5-room flats coming second at about 155 billion Singapore dollars, or roughly 30% of all HDB. So again, really, there are all sorts of different ways that you can slice and segment things, you know, be it HDB, condo, or landed. And actually, in the future, we're gonna have individual episode about individual town and district where we go into things in a lot more detail. Besides breaking things down by into categories and segmenting them by certain dimensions, we can also rank this data. And here's how it would look. So we start from the cheapest home in Singapore. So clearly a HDB, right, at just over 100,000 Singapore dollars. And as we move along, we see a very gradual increase in prices because there are just a lot of HDB flats that are very similar in valuation. HDB is basically a fairly homogeneous housing class. But as we reach around the 500,000 point, that's where we start seeing some condo units. You can see here that the condo units are climbing a lot faster than the HDB. And then all of a sudden, you see landed coming in past the $1 million mark, and those really skyrocket even quicker than the condos. Now you must be wondering how come, you know, everything kind of stopped at $29 million for the landed. Obviously there are landed that are way more expensive than just $29 million, even though $29 million is already very expensive. Actually, in order for us to run this animation, we actually cannot afford to put every single data point, which is 1.6 million homes, into this whole chart, right? The rent animation just won't run. So we actually had to take a shortcut here by grouping every 1,000 homes into one bucket and then taking the median of that 1,000 home. But because we are looking at median value, so that's why the extreme values in that bucket are being hidden away. So that's why you don't see the crazy expensive one. Nonetheless, once you zoom out to the whole chart, you see the full picture. In fact, at this scale, the whole HDB line looks like a flat long horizontal line, while the condo and landed just shoot up like a rocket towards the end. And in fact, if you look towards this very end, that's basically where all your so-called crazy rich Asian homes are located. While this may seem like very extreme, you know, if you just look at this chart, right, the rich is so much richer than, you know, the rest of us. But frankly, if you look into it a bit further, at least for me, I actually reach a somewhat different conclusion. So I'm sure you guys have heard of this concept of Power's Law, or they call it Pareto's Law, basically 20-80, right, where the top 20% typically, you know, account for 80% of the whole. And you see it in a lot of places, in a lot of domains, especially in terms of wealth distribution. And in fact, some countries is way more extreme than 20-80. But in terms of in Singapore, if you take out the top 20% of all properties in Singapore, it turns out that these only account for 57% of the entire housing stock in terms of value, right? So you don't see this whole 20-80 thing. In fact, what you see is 20-57, right? Or 20-60. And so I think this is a testament to the success of this whole HDB program in Singapore, where HDB really provide a very substantial asset base, you know, for the middle to lower income household in Singapore. And therefore, you don't see this extreme, you know, distribution in terms of house worth. Okay, now that we've taken the numbers and split it a couple of times, right, and I think what we should do is try to really wrap our head around this huge number, right, this 1.43 trillion Singapore dollars. I mean, it's just a mind-boggling number. It's hard to imagine, like, it's very hard to think about this. So the way I would like to propose for us to think about this is to use it to compare against our GDP. Singapore's GDP in 2018 is actually 491 billion Singapore dollars. So we are really looking at a 2.9 times multiple, right? So that's the size of the house stock relative to our GDP. Now, is 2.9 times a big number or a small number? Really, the way to interpret it is to compare to another market. Turns out in US, there's this company called Zillow, which is basically another real estate company, and they also have their own auto valuation AI called Zestimate. And they've actually gone through the same exercise where they tried to use their AI to value every single home in US. And what they found was that the entire US homes are worth 33.3 trillion US dollar. Huge number, obviously. In other words, if we were to convert our, you know, 1.43, this is in Sing dollars, into US dollar, what it means is that the US housing market in terms of value is roughly 30 times that of the one in Singapore. Now, obviously, we can do the same thing with the US market, so we can use that housing stock value to compare against US GDP. And what you get is basically a housing to GDP multiple of just 1.6x. Now, ours is at 2.9x, and US has a much lower number at 1.6x. So what gives? Now, the way I interpret this, right, is Singapore has a much higher savings rate than US, right? We have something like 48% of savings rate versus US 17%. So the formation of financial assets is tied to savings, right? No savings, no investments. So I think our high savings rate is one of the contributing factor. And then on top of that, we also have a very high home ownership, right? We have more than 90% kind of home ownership versus US at about just 65%. So basically our affinity to real estate as well as our high savings rate, I think basically both compound to contribute to this very high, you know, kind of a housing stock to GDP multiple. A lot of our wealth is just being accrued and manifest in the form of real estate as a financial asset class. So truth be told, I'm not an economist. So if you have a much more rigorous kind of explanation of this difference in, you know, housing stock to GDP multiple, I would love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. Now, finally, what can we actually use this piece of new insight or data for? I think that if you're a policymaker, or if you're a urban planner or central banker, or, you know, a big time real estate developers, new insights like these that are facilitated and guided by new developments in AI can really complement some of the traditional more macro kind of analysis. And in fact, let me give you a concrete example of actually something that we're trying to develop into a product, what we call a neighborhood intelligence report. The so-called insight we have is that valuation of a home is actually a very close proxy to the household income of whoever is living in that home. So obviously someone living in a HDB is of a different financial standing than someone living in a good class bungalow, right? So I think everyone understands that. Now, given our knowledge of the distribution of every single home and how much they're worth within specific location in Singapore, in theory, what we can do is if you give us a specific location, we can literally tell you, okay, within 500 meters of this location, you have how many households and here's the distribution of their home value. And therefore, you know, we can make some pretty educated guesses about the distribution of the household income. And you can probably also make some guess about the population as well. Say if you are a shopping mall landlord or you're a big retailer like McDonald's, right? Every McDonald's you're gonna open is gonna be $1-2 million kind of investment. So if you have some kind of data like the one we kind of have now, and then combined with other data like footfall or traffic pattern, I think this kind of neighborhood intelligence insight can really help you make a more informed decision when you pick which location to open your next McDonald's. So there you have it. Again, this is a study done by our team at UrbanZoom. We really put our heart and soul into this one and we are very proud of what we've done. But if you are just like us, you know, you are data junkies, you love data and you like all these stories that data can tell, then definitely, you know, consider subscribing to this channel because we're going to keep pumping up content just like this one. Again, my name is Mike Cho from UrbanZoom. I'll see you in the next one.